Hi, I'm Grant Dietrich, and I'm the Group 1 lead for Experiment 7, which is observing the behaviors of internal combustion engines. So the internal combustion engine that we're going to be observing is actually a reciprocating four-stroke spark plug ignition engine. This is actually opposed to, if you look at this diagram right here, you can see kind of what two of those categories are met. It's reciprocating in that it moves in this up and down motion. It is spark plug ignition because there's going to be spark plug here at the top. And then the last one is four stroke, which means that it goes through four strokes to complete a cycle. This is composed to rotary compression and two stroke. If you look at old BMW engines, they use rotary, which is kind of this triangle that's inside of this oval shape, and it kind of moves around and rotates. We're going to be looking at it on an auto cycle, which means that you treat the space inside of this piston as a control volume. And the engines that we're actually looking at are going to be ones that are used for lawnmowers. And there's also, they use the same principle for like a car engine as well. So looking at each stroke, the stroke is whenever it moves from top dead center to bottom dead center, which is as high up or as far down as the piston can go. If you actually break down each stroke, you can have the inlet or suction whenever it pulls in the fluid or the gas, sort of like how a syringe works. It then pushes the fluid up towards a spark plug and compresses it, going from 1 to 2. From 2 to 3, this is the ignition. It's an instantaneous heat that's added to the system. This isn't actually one of the strokes, but what follows is, and this is the power stroke. This is the most important part, arguably, because this is the whole point of the engine. It translates that combustion energy into rotary mechanical energy that's going to drive the crankshaft. Then it has to let some heat out. In any system that involves work, you can't just have heat in and then have just translate it all into work. There's going to have to be some heat out. And once that happens, it then pushes that burnt fuel out of the system. So the graph that we were just looking at was an ideal cycle. A couple of things that make it ideal is that going from 1 to 2 and from 3 to 4, it is work that's both reversible and adiabatic, making this line right here an isentrope for each one. So S1 and S2 values are going to be the same, and S3 and S4 values are going to be the same as well. Like I said, the heat in is going to be instantaneous. Realistically, that's not really going to be the case. During combustion, it kind of pushes the piston back so it doesn't just explode and the piston sits there. It's going to actually push it back a little bit, which is why it kind of loops around. And then during the heat out, it doesn't exactly get down to the same pressure as 1 to 4. Also, the work between 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 are not going to be isentropic. Now we can move on to the procedure itself. The first thing you have to know is there's going to be a higher safety that you're going to have to be aware of in this lab. You're not just looking at an air conditioning unit, or you're not just dipping a thermocoupler in water. This lab is considerably more dangerous than the other ones. Wear eye and ear protection. It's going to be a smaller motor. Like I said, it's more like a lawnmower kind of motor, but it's going to be inside of this enclosed space, so there's going to be a lot of acoustics. There's going to be a lot of noise reverberating off the wall, so ear protection is a must. Obviously, stay away from moving parts. Don't put your hand on the torque arm. Don't put your hand on the crankshaft. They emphasize this, I don't know why. And then, of course, the space bar is an auto kill switch. It's going to be set up. It's going to be hooked up to the engine as well. So if anything were to happen, you can hit the space bar and you can kind of stop the whole procedure. Now we can move on to the procedure itself. Obviously, take care of safety. Remember that there are also going to be carbon monoxide detectors. So if the fume levels get a bit too high in the room, you can evacuate either to the right side of the room or the left side of the room. There is also going to be the computer setup. You just set up the computer. There's about 30 something steps in between, so I'm not going to really list all of them out. But please be aware of the lab manual and all the steps that you have to follow. And then you can start the engine and make sure that the exhaust ports are open. And then you can perform the tests. We're actually going to be performing both variable load and variable speed tests with load and respectable one. Here's the apparatus itself. There are a lot of parts here, but most of them are used to just bolt the engine and the torque arm and the dynamometer down to this table. And I'd like to really just draw your attention to the engine, the torque arm, and the dynamometer itself. Those are going to be the key parts in this experiment. And actually what the dynamometer even does is that it measures how much power the engine puts out. It does this by actually getting two things because it can't measure power directly. The one that we're going to use is the water brake dynamometer, and it needs two things. Like I said, it needs RPM and it needs torque. It actually gets the RPM just simply how most cars and other vehicles get the RPM. It just measures it on this gauge. But to get the torque, it's a bit more tricky. You see the engine setup right here. It has the crankshaft that actually is connected to this other shaft, and that shaft not only goes through the cylinder, but also through this thing that looks like a bicycle chain right here, and that's this torque arm. So what happens is that cylinder has water pumped into it, and the water brake dynamometer uses water. And so it adds more water if it wants to increase the load. And these fans right here kind of oppose it, so as it's beginning to spin, this water is trying to slow it down. And you see how much force this motor right here has to put on the scale. With torque and RPM found, you can now find the power, and it's used by this power relation right here. Horsepower is equal to torque times angular velocity, and then of course you have this conversion factor, which is found when you multiply 550 times 2 pi divided by 60, and that's 5252. If you look at this chart right here, you'll see that horsepower and torque cross. You can see mathematically from this formula why and when they cross. Whenever the RPM is equal to 5252, these two cancel out, leaving horsepower equal to torque. And you can see right around here, that's 5252. This is ideally going to be the same for each motor, and it can actually vary. In fact, this graph is just for one particular engine. Torque can actually continue to increase after these two cross, maybe even for a little bit, but eventually torque is going to have to drop. But just know, even if torque increases, horsepower is going to have to increase the same proportionate to W over 5252. Here's some more equations. These are kind of just thrown at me in the manual. There wasn't much background to these, but you can see that these are actually pretty important in finding, I'm going to show you in a little bit. They're important finding the braking effective pressure, and they're important finding just the power. You can see that here's AF. This is actually the ratio due to air and fuel. The mixture inside of that piston cylinder is going to be gas and air, so it's important to find how much air is inside of it, and then you can see how effectively the engine uses that flow of air. And then you can see how much it converts the fuel to power, and then, of course, how much it's efficient mechanically was. You can also find the thermal efficiency of it as well. You can use this using the same formula that you use for a Rankine cycle. Just going to be work out is equal to usually Q in minus Q out. And then here's some more equations. Again, this is the braking effective pressure. It uses this sort of conglomeration of all the equations that you found on the previous slide, including the ratio fuel to air, and then of course power as well. Get my references. Are there any questions?